Miss Aussie. I'll get him started. All right, we're going to go. Let's wait for Miss Jeanette to get in here, Miss Aussie, and then once Miss Jeanette gets in, we'll go ahead and get started. If you can find your way to your seats there, we're going to go ahead and get started with the worship service. We are very glad to have so many people here with us today, and some from far away, and we're thankful that you have chosen to go ahead and worship with us today. So if you didn't get a bulletin as you walked in, you might want to take a quick little walk back there and go ahead and get one. It'll help you with regard to the order of service here today. But we're going to go and start with our call to worship, and the call to worship is number 102, and it'll just be the first verse. So call to worship is number 102 in the hymnal. There is definitely something about that name. It is the most glorious name of all. Nothing can stand against that name. And with that, I would ask that you turn now to the back of your hymnals to number 716, which is the Apostles' Creed. It's listed there for you. If you're able to, I'd ask that you stand as we go ahead and jointly united with one another, go ahead and recite this as a affirmation of the essentials of our faith. So just join me, please. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into Hades. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. And with that, our next hymn will be number 1. Should be easy to find there at the front of the hymnal. Joyful, joyful, we adore thee. And Miss Aussie?
Great verse. Just first, second, and last.
First, second, and last. Pray. Father God, we come to you joyful for the opportunity that we have to be able to gather here freely, to be able to express our worship to you, the one who is worthy. Father, we thank you for this time, for this sanctuary. We thank you for all those who are present today. Lord, that you would be with those, especially those of our families and our congregation that are unable to be with us here today. Father, we ask now that your Holy Spirit would abide here with us as we go through the rest of this worship service, that as we give all of our attention to you, our hearts are focused on you as well. Lord, that you would be glorified in all that we say and all that we do. We ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. Good morning.
Good morning.
Well, we have people all from all around the country here with us today. It is so good to have you with us. I'm not going to, last week, I forget who it was, but I called people out by name, and that's just kind of one of the things that happens when you're in a small church here. You know, when people show up, it's pretty easy for us to go ahead. So I'm not going to go ahead and call anybody out today, but we are very happy to have you with us today. Thank you for joining us. Thank you for choosing to worship with us today. Thank you for honoring us with your presence, and thank you just for choosing to go ahead and be here. If you take a look at your bulletin there on the inside, we'll just go through a few announcements today. First of all, we are not going to have our choir, as we're already not doing at the moment, and we're not going to go ahead and have choir practice tonight either. Karen and I will be leaving this afternoon, and so we will, as I was telling Aussie up here just a moment ago, we will get back on track here, and we will get the choir going again. It's just not going to be this week right now. So you all then will be the choir for today, bringing those praises to God's ears and bringing a smile to his face. So all of you are in the choir today. Secondly, let me go ahead and point out that I will be on vacation starting later today through early next week. You here at the church, if you have any kinds of issues or needs, please go ahead and contact the elders of the church first to go ahead and get any assistance that you may need from them. And certainly if they need to get in touch with me, they have my contact information, they can do so as well. As many of you have been hearing probably over the last several weeks, if not months, my parents are moving to Florida, and their stuff got picked up yesterday. And Karen and I will be going over there today, and then we will be caravanning down on Tuesday. So that's the reason for my vacation. Not much of a vacation, but grateful that I have the opportunity to serve my parents that way. I say all that to say on Wednesday I won't be here. So unless Brother Mark or somebody or Sadira want to go ahead and teach the Wednesday morning Bible study, which I didn't see anybody volunteer either now or this past Wednesday, we had agreed that we were not going to meet until the following Wednesday. So there will not be a Wednesday morning Bible study this week. So all of you who regularly come there, gives you 2 weeks to go ahead and read the scripture verses for the following week, or you can take a week off as well. So no Wednesday morning Bible study this week. We have some birthdays here that we want to go ahead and recognize. Today's birthday, I believe this is Ben and Donnell's granddaughter, Mary Ashley. She is celebrating a birthday today. And then Stephanie Gilliland will be later this week. Kenny is later this week as well with my granddaughter, Allison Hubbard, celebrating her birthday on Friday. So with that, are there any other announcements, I guess in particular, from the congregation here at Green's Chapel or from our visitors that perhaps you would like to go ahead and bring greetings from your church or from your state or from wherever you came from today and just greet us today? Are any other announcements or any greetings? And we are very grateful that you did. Looking forward to eating with you guys a little bit later on as well.
I'm very much looking forward to some country food.
Oh, yes.
Very much of that in Florida.
Yeah. There's a lot of good food in this area. None of us are going hungry, I can tell you that much. Anybody else? Miss Martha.
I have one son-in-law who just left Florida, going back to North
Carolina. Is his name Bob?
Mm-hmm. Something to do tomorrow.
Okay.
And you were doing birthdays.
Yes.
My first grandchild has a birthday today, and he's 45, if y'all remember.
Wow. And who is that, Miss Martha?
It's Daniel Dixon.
Daniel Dixon. 45 today. All right. There's been one or two things have happened since then. Just a couple. All right. Any other announcements? All right, then. Let's go ahead and continue with our worship then, and we will sing our next hymn, which is number 196.
Don't we need to sing happy birthday first?
We can, although I'm not sure that we have
anybody on it for this week.
Well, we do, but none of them are present right now.
Okay, that's so, nice with somebody there this morning.
Yes. So, yeah, no one's with us in person today. There may be some with us that are going to watch this later. But for those of you that are celebrating a birthday today, including Daniel, happy birthday.
196.
196. Which verses?
First, second, last.
So, first, second, and last.
Lose all their guilty sins.
Reminded, even as we were singing that there, as I look out in the congregation, I know that you can't necessarily see yourselves, but what I see is peace. The peace that I see that you have here is the peace that you have in Christ, having had your sins forgiven and being reconciled to God the Father. And yeah, there may be things going on in all of our lives, because there are, right? I mean, there are things going on in each one of our lives that cause us to have issues, anxiety, things that we're trying to resolve or whatever else. But you know, just as that hymn there goes ahead and talks about that the fountain of blood that goes ahead and brings peace to our lives, that's what I see when I see you. And I'm grateful. I'm grateful for God in terms of not only that he's done that for me, but that he's done that for you as well. Turn, please, to the back of the hymnal one more time. I think this is the last time I'll ask you to do this today for our responsive reading. It is number 631. It's Obedience. It's on the right-hand page, left-hand column, kind of near the bottom there. And our Sunday school curriculum for this quarter has been the major theme of obedience, and here we will also respond with some corporate worship here with respect to this responsive reading to go ahead and see what the Word tells us about obedience as well. I will read and try not to step on your toes, just those passages here that are not in bold, and if you can, please respond in unison then to those that are in bold. Obedience. Therefore, thou shalt love the Lord thy God and keep his charge and his statutes and his judgments and his commandments always.
For this commandment which I have commanded thee this day, it is not hidden from thee, neither is it far off.
It is not in heaven that thou shouldest say, who shall go up for us to heaven and bring it unto us, that we may hear it and do it.
Neither is it beyond the sea, that thou shouldest say, who shall go up the sea for us and bring it unto us, that we may hear it and do it.
But the word is very nigh unto thee in thy mouth and in thy heart, that thou mayest do it.
This book of the law shall not depart out of thy mouth. Thou shalt
Hath the Lord as great delight in burnt offerings and sacrifices as in obeying the verse of the voice of the Lord? Behold, to obey is better than sacrifice, and to hearken than the fat of rams.
He that hath my commandments and keepeth them, he it is that loveth me, and he that loveth me shall be loved of my Father, and I will love him.
Jesus answered and said unto him, if a man love me, he will keep my words, and my Father will love him, and we will come unto him and make our abode with him.
Though he were a son, yet learned he obedience to the things which he suffered.
By faith, Abraham, when he was called to go into a place which he should after receive for an inheritance obeyed, and he went out not knowing whither he went.
And through God we do know that we know him if we keep his commandments.
I'm going to just briefly mention this. You may get tired of hearing it, especially those that are here pretty much every Sunday. It never ceases to amaze me how God works in various ways. There are some scripture passages. Everything that we just read comes from a number of different scripture passages. And in particular, the one there from Joshua almost ended up in the sermon last night as I was preparing for today. I ended up not, and I didn't know exactly why at the time why I did not include that, because it certainly would have fit. But now I know why. And so I'm just grateful for God in terms of the way in which he uses Sidera to go ahead and select the appropriate responsive readings for us. And Sidera and I, we don't collude at all. Matter of fact, I send her, usually it's on Thursday night, I send her the scripture verses that I feel like God has led me to go ahead and preach on Sunday. And other than that, we don't talk about, what the responsive reading is going to be or anything. But again, I think it's just an affirmation in terms of the Spirit of God here at this place with regard to this congregation that we see such synchrony with respect to some of the things that we see in our service today. With that, I will let you know that we, ever since the pandemic occurred here and afterwards, we have decided at this point, which may be permanent, I'm not sure yet, to leave our offering plate in the vestibule back there. So you may have seen it as you came in, you may not have. If by some chance you have tithes and or offerings that you were not able to leave there on the way in, you can certainly go ahead and do so on your way out. Again, I want to affirm and commend the congregation, the members here at Green's Chapel, for their faithfulness and their obedience in terms of giving to the Lord, as well as above and beyond in the offerings. I will say this in light of the storm that just went through Florida and some of the other states as it came back around and all that, Hurricane Ian. The session did go ahead and agree to send $500, I believe was the amount that we decided on, $500 in addition to those offerings that were made by the congregation, and we agreed to go ahead and send that to Samaritan's Purse. So that money has already gone out, Ms. Sidera? Yes, so that money's already been sent. So please know in your hearts when God leads you to do things like that, that we are very obedient and trustworthy to be able to take that money and to direct it to where it needs to go in order for God to go ahead and help the people that he needs to go ahead and help there. So again, just want to commend you on your giving. And I know that there are some of you here today that even though you aren't here every Sunday, you send in offerings as well. And I want to thank you for your support of this church. It means an awful lot to us to be able to continue the ministry here. With that, if you'll open up your bulletin there, we have those that we have been praying for. I guess the first thing that I want to bring to your attention, if you haven't already seen on Faith Life, unfortunately, Mark's wife, Mary, was involved in a car accident on Thursday. She was coming home from teaching down there in Tarrant. I don't know if the insurance company has decided whether the car is totaled yet. Okay, so don't know there. Mark did take Mary to the hospital to get checked out on Thursday. Last I heard from him yesterday, Mary's still sore, really sore. Praise God. Praise God that Mary and this other person, that the other person wasn't a split second later, and that Mary wasn't a split second. I mean, that's all it would have been, a split second. Because if it had been a split second in either way, that car would have hit her broadside right on the driver's side. And if you've ever been in a car accident before, hopefully you haven't, and hopefully you won't. But if you haven't, you've probably never thought about the physics involved in terms of what happens with that. But anyhow, even with a seatbelt on, when you get hit from the side, your body is going to go this way and this way, and that means you're either going to hit on the left-hand side if you're on the driver's side, or if you're on the passenger side, you're going to hit on the other side, your head, your neck, your shoulder, all that. Mary is doing fine, but she's very sore right now. They have made plans things to go ahead and have a rental car for her to be able to go back to work this week and all that. But please go ahead and keep Mary and Mark in your prayers there. Likewise, let me also go ahead and say that last week we had been praying for Mark's granddaughter, Cheyenne, and last I heard there, things are going well there as well. So want to continue to ask for your prayers there. Miss Aussie, I know that she's been recovering nicely from at least the procedure on her on one of her legs. Do we have any word yet, Miss Aussie, on when the second one might be scheduled?
No, they didn't call me yet.
Okay, all right then. So we just want to thank. Okay. All right. So we'll just continue to wait for God's timing in that with respect to the doctors and getting that lined up for her second leg there, but continue to keep Miss Aussie in your prayers as well. We have a number of people here, loved ones that we've been praying for, Joe Beatty in particular as well, with regard to his treatments for his prostate cancer. Please continue to keep him. Of course, all of you know about Robert as well, and some of the difficulties that he's been going through. Last I heard from Joe, which is over a week old now, Robert had been doing well. But we've also had lost loved ones recently. The last one that I recall was Janet's cousin. And so we want to go ahead and continue to pray for those families. I did go ahead and visit with Diane Gilliland also this past week. Diane and Gerald, as all of you I'm sure are aware, having lost Gavin here in July, are still struggling with that, and rightfully so. They will struggle with that for a long time, but God can go ahead and see them through it. They will never get over it. They will never forget. It has changed their life forever, as those of you who may have also lost children or grandchildren or great-grandchildren know. It is a pain, and it is a loss that is incomparable to any other loss. So please go ahead and keep Diane and Gerald in your prayers also. So what other praise items and or prayer requests might we have to bring to the Lord this morning, or updates even on those that we've been praying for? Don't be shy, especially if you're visiting. It's okay. We're grateful. I'm grateful. Here's a praise item that all of you arrived here safely, and we're praying that Bob and is it Daniel who are on their way back right now? Yeah, that Bob and Daniel are going to go ahead and have safe passages as well. Okay.
This is our first stop.
All right.
So pray for safe travels for us, and that we don't kill each other in an RV.
All right. And how long is the trip?
3.5 weeks.
3.5 weeks. All right. That's going to be fun. Are you guys going west or?
Well, we're kind of doing a big circle of the southeast.
Okay.
So tomorrow we head to Nashville. Right. And then from there to Gatlinburg, over to Asheville, Charlotte.
Yeah. Wonderful. All right. That sounds wonderful. All right. That sounds like it'd be a lot of fun. All right. Good. Anything else? It's always good to have Miss Jeanette with us. Well, let's go to the Lord in prayer then. Lord, we come into your throne room this morning confident but humble. Confident in who you are and all that you have done in our lives, all that you did even before we were born, to be able to prepare a way for us to be reconciled to you by the blood of Christ. Lord, we thank you for even today and this opportunity to gather before you, but also to bring our offers and our sacrifices. Now at this point, we are living sacrifices, our lives, that we place them upon the altar that you might be glorified and pleased with them as well. Lord, we have many things and people that are on our minds right now, and some of those may be unspoken requests. We know that you know each and every one of those, that we do not necessarily need to verbalize them, although as we verbalize them here with fellow brothers and sisters, that we can count on their support as well as we bring them to you. Father, we thank you for the healing that you continue to bring to those in our congregation, especially Brother David, as well as Miss Aussie. Father, for keeping Miss Mary from even a more tragic accident here on Thursday, and for the healing and recovery that's already going on in her body. We thank you for your hand of protection there. Father, for... it's Lori, right? Yes, for Lori and Lane, as they go ahead and embark on this 3.5-week journey in an RV, and all these plans that they have and the various places to go ahead and see and do things, Father, that you would give them protection and safe passage out there as they're on the roads, and allow them to be able to experience and enjoy all of the world that you have created here for us to be able to enjoy, giving them the opportunity to relax and refresh and draw closer to one another, as well as to draw closer to you also. Lord, we thank you for the ways in which you are working in our congregation. We thank you for the healing that you are bringing even to Miss Janet. We thank you for all the children that are here today and the opportunity to influence their lives, to be able to plant those seeds, and for your Holy Spirit to water them, to grow up a harvest in their lives that would go ahead and prepare them to be those faithful servants that you have called and created them to be as well. Father, for all those that are celebrating birthdays this week, we acknowledge and recognize your hand of divinity there with respect to being the giver of life. And we thank you for those parents that made the choice to bring life into the world as opposed to those that may have chosen otherwise. Lord, we continue to thank you for this church, for those that grew up in the church, for those that still live here and serve this church and this community, for the faithful tithes and offerings that are being brought to this church. And Father, that you would continue to have your hand upon even the session as they continue to be faithful stewards of all that you bring into this church as well. Lord, we thank you just for the opportunity that we have, for the blessings that you have given, and for the life that we have yet to come, that we might glorify you in all that we do. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. If you will, you can be turning to our scripture passage for today. It's one of the lectionary passages. It is Psalm 119. And it is actually verses 97 through 104. I know Miss Sadira confided in me early this morning. She said, "Did you see the mistake I made this morning?" I said, "No, I really didn't." She has it as 99 through 104, but it's actually 97. And so we will start there. Book of Psalms, an important book, certainly for our Jewish brothers and sisters in terms of the past, as well as for us today also. A songbook for them, but also a songbook for us, as well as meaningful scripture in there that is important to our lives even today. This is Psalm 119, starting in verse 97 through 104, and this is the word of God for us, the people of God. Oh, how love I thy law. It is my meditation all the day. Thou, through thy commandments, hast made me wiser than mine enemies, for they are ever with me. I have more understanding than all my teachers, for thy testimonies are my meditation. I understand more than the ancients, because I keep thy precepts. I have refrained my feet from every evil way, that I might keep thy word. I have not departed from thy judgments, for thou hast taught me. How sweet are thy words unto my taste, yea, sweeter than honey to my mouth. Through thy precepts I get understanding, therefore I hate every false way. Let's pray. Father God, I just pray right now that as it appears to me, you have already ordained not only this particular passage today, but also the word and the message that is to come from it. May it be your message, may it be your words, and use me as your faithful servant to deliver them. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. Well, this past week in our Wednesday morning Bible study, we went through the first 15 verses of Acts chapter 17, and you may not have that memorized, and for some of those that were in the Wednesday morning Bible study, they may have already forgotten some of it. So let me just remind you that in those particular verses, Luke is recording some of, not all, but some of the details concerning Paul's second missionary journey, as he and Silas end up going into the city of Thessalonica, where after successfully preaching the gospel, there is a great many people that come to the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ, both Jews and Greeks getting saved there. And then after that, as becomes a pattern in Paul's ministry, they're run out of town. And from there, they move on to the city of Berea, which is also located there in Greece. As a result of Paul's preaching and teaching there in Berea, a great many Jews and Gentiles again get saved before the Jews in Thessalonica, some 50 miles away, start to hear of the good things that are going on by Paul's preaching there in Berea, and they come 50 miles to incite the people in Berea against Paul and his companions, after which Paul at that point is escorted out of the city by sea down to Athens for his own protection by some of the brothers there in Berea. Now, embedded in those 15 verses is verse 11, which says the following. Now these Jews, speaking about the Jews in Berea, these Jews were more noble than those in Thessalonica. They received the word with all eagerness, examining the scriptures daily to see if these things were so. I love that verse. I said that on Wednesday at the Bible study. It is one of my favorite verses in Scripture, and in particular in the New Testament, for the simple reason that it shows us a positive example of just how the Bereans used the Scriptures, which at that time would have only been the Old Testament. And they used it to check and to validate that what someone was telling them, whether it was true or not. In today's culture, where people at all levels of society say and write whatever is convenient and beneficial to them and to their cause, there are some people and organizations that, at least in this country, try to attempt to verify or fact check whether or not these people are telling the truth. Now, what the Apostle Paul was preaching to the Jews first and then to the Gentiles on these missionary journeys was that the long-awaited Messiah that God had promised had finally come. His name was Jesus, and he came from Nazareth. And all that he could rely on in his preaching and his teaching was, one, his own experiences, as well as, two, the Old Testament. Now, I don't have time today to go through all of Paul's story up to this point, how his experience confirmed his message regarding Jesus as the Messiah, and how the Holy Spirit had been confirming Paul's calling in bringing the gospel to the Jews first and then to the Gentiles. But for the sake of argument, let's just agree that not everyone tells the truth about their experiences to begin with. And even if they do, it doesn't necessarily prove something as important as the coming of the long-awaited Messiah. However, God had given a great number of clues and pieces of evidence that did point to the Messiah, which we refer to as the Messianic prophecies, and they were contained in the Old Testament. And so, upon hearing what Paul had told them in his preaching and teaching about Jesus, these Jews in Berea, they went back to the scriptures, which was not an easy task, because everyone in that day didn't even have their own copy or access to multiple copies as we do today. But they gathered what they had access to, and they examined the scriptures for themselves daily, daily, over an extended period of time to see whether or not Paul was actually telling the truth. And many of them, in their eagerness of hearing Paul's preaching along with the anointing of the Holy Spirit, found confirmation of the truthfulness of his message in the scriptures. Our culture today doesn't place any value at all on the Bible, what it says, or even where it came from, unless there happens to be maybe a verse or two that can be completely taken out of context and used for their own earthly purposes. And you really don't need to look very far or even take very long to see the negative consequences that it is having on all of us. The days of honoring, cherishing, even fearing God's word, and even God, may be long gone for the majority of people living today. And what about us, those who profess to be followers of Jesus Christ, this same Messiah that Paul preached about, that the Bereans looked into the scriptures to verify his message? When we hear people saying things, or when we read what other people have written, do we turn to the scriptures to verify their truthfulness? Or to put it another way, do we allow the truth of God's word to guide and direct us, to give us discernment and understanding, not just when we come to church on Sunday or maybe Wednesday morning for a Bible study, but in every aspect of our lives and everything that we do? The book of Psalms is a collection of 150 songs and hymns that was used by the Jews in all aspects of their lives and their worship to God. Not surprisingly, the first two verses of Psalm 1 give us a promise of blessing as well as a reminder of the priority and the importance of God's word in our lives. As the psalmist writes, blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the wicked, nor stands in the way of sinners, nor sits in the seat of scoffers, but his delight is in the law of the Lord. And on his law, he meditates day and night. Our scripture for today's sermon comes from Psalm 119. This particular psalm happens to be the longest psalm in the book of Psalms. Not only that, it is also the longest chapter in all the 66 books of the Bible, consisting of 176 verses. Now that number, 176, probably doesn't mean much to you. But it happens to be the number you get when you multiply 8, which is the number of verses in our scripture passage today. If you multiply 8 by 22, you get 176, where 22 just happens to be the number of characters in the Hebrew alphabet. So there are then, in Psalm 119, 22 sets of 8 verse sections that make up all of this psalm. And it turns out, if that's not amazing enough, it turns out that the first set of 8 verses all begin with the first letter of the Hebrew alphabet, Aleph. The second set of 8 verses all begin with the second letter of the Hebrew alphabet, Beth. Verses 97 through 104 are the 8 verses that all begin with the Hebrew letter Mem, which is essentially equivalent to our letter M. Of course, if you look at your English translations there, you will quickly see that each of these verses don't begin with the letter M. And that's because it has been translated from Hebrew, and the word order of what the psalmist wrote doesn't necessarily equate to the way in which we structure our sentences today. If you truly want to see this for yourself, that there are 22 sets of 8 verses that all begin with the letters of the Hebrew alphabet in order, making up the entire 76 verses of Psalm 119, what you should do is go online, because probably none of us have this at the house, including me. You want to find a Hebrew interlinear Bible. A Hebrew interlinear Bible. And look at Psalm 119 and see how this works. For example, take a look at your own translation there in verse 97. The English word for word translation directly from the Hebrew would be the following. Oh, how I love your law all the day. It is my meditation, which is fairly close, right? Fairly close to what you probably have in your Bible. The first Hebrew word in that verse is ma, which starts with mem, which is translated, oh, how. But take a look at verse 98. The direct English word-for-word translation, which you would find in a Hebrew interlinear, for that verse into English would be the following. Than my enemies, you make me wiser through your commandments forever. It is mine. Not quite the same as what you have there in your translation. In that verse, the first Hebrew word is meoyabai, which also starts with mem, which is translated as than my enemies. Now, if all that wasn't impressive enough, it turns out that there is also one other aspect of Psalm 119 that is completely almost unbelievable. Nearly every one of the 176 verses uniquely and directly refer to the Word of God. It doesn't always use the same word, as we will see even in our 8 verses for today, but isn't it amazing to think that this one psalmist was able to come up with 176 different ways of referring to the Word of God and how it should be a part of our lives? And so with that rather long introduction, let's take a look at these 8 verses here in Psalms 119 that all begin with the Hebrew letter mem. Verse 97 says, oh, how I love your law, it is my meditation all the day. Well, can any of us truly say that? Do any of us truly meditate on God's word all day or even every day? Not that you have to actually open up a Bible in order to meditate on God's word, right? You don't necessarily have to do that. If you have scripture memorized, and I certainly hope that you do, and that there are important passages that you carry with you in your heart that bring you peace and comfort and guidance and strength in your life. Or even if you frequently listen to a good biblical preacher or teacher, as long as you're hearing God's word spoken to and proclaimed to you, it's possible to meditate on it that way also, is it not? So although the easiest way may be for any of us to meditate on God's word is by just actually reading it for ourselves out of our own Bible, perhaps during a daily devotion time, and then meditate on it for the rest of the day. Although that may be the easiest way, it's not required that it be done that way. But with all the ways today in which we can have access to God's word, do we meditate on it at least at some part during the day? And if not, we should. Because if we don't, not only are we not getting the type of teaching and strengthening that we need in order to be the people that God wants us to be, the type of teaching and strengthening in order to deal with the spiritual warfare that we find ourselves in day after day, but if we don't meditate on it, making it a primary focus and of great importance to us, how? How can we ever get to the point of saying, God, how I truly, sincerely, and genuinely love your law? love your word. How I love it, how I need it, how I desire it, how it brings me close to you. And that's not only what you want, but I want also, Lord. And your law, your word, it does that. And I love it. Looking at verse 98. Your commandment makes me wiser than my enemies, for it is ever with me. Now, I've already mentioned the spiritual warfare that we are in, which means that all of us have at least one enemy, Satan, and his demons that are after us. God's word helps us to understand all of our enemies, including him, his ways, his motives, even his tactics, so we don't have to be vulnerable to him. God is all-knowing, Satan is not. God is all-powerful, Satan is not. God is everywhere, Satan is not. Even those people who have been deceived by Satan and his demons, spirits, are no match for God and for his word. Time and time again, the Bible gives us insight and instruction to be applied in our lives so that we do not have to feel like we are at the mercy of the enemy, that he is winning and that we might be losing. No, here in verse 98, the psalmist reminds us that God's word, his commandments, that they make us wiser than our enemies because it is always with us and because we are faithful to apply it in the situations that we find ourselves. Or at least if we would, we did. In verse 99, the psalmist writes, I have more understanding than all my teachers, for your testimonies are my meditation. Now, for all the children, grandchildren, great-grandchildren, especially those who are still in school, I do not recommend that you take this literally and go to your teachers now and say that you have more understanding than they do. Just because we read the Bible, it doesn't necessarily make us smarter, more knowledgeable than what our teachers are. While everything in the Bible is true, not all truth is in the Bible. You won't find a book in the Bible that covers all the postulates and all the theorems that many of us don't remember from our geometry classes. What the psalmist is saying is that from a worldly perspective, in the things that really matter in life, and especially with respect to relationships and the way in which we live our life, having a biblical understanding and worldview will give us a better understanding than those who don't have a biblical basis. Again, though, this presumes that we aren't just reading what God's word says, but are allowing it to mold and transform us to permeate into our lives as we meditate and allow its teachings and insights because it comes from an all-knowing God. In verse 100, we read, I understand more than the aged, for I keep your precepts. Now, just because someone is chronologically older than us doesn't necessarily make them more knowledgeable or wiser than we are. Likewise, just because someone may have lived many years or even centuries before us doesn't necessarily make them wiser either. Do we honor and respect our elders? Absolutely, especially our parents. Is it possible for us to learn from those who came before us? Again, the answer is yes. But age in and of itself or past history does not necessarily equate to more understanding or more wisdom. God's precepts, those truths that are contained in his word, are infinitely older than anyone who might be alive today or anyone who lived before us. And they bring us far greater understanding of life than just either the passage of time, no matter how long that may be, or how long ago someone may have lived. Likewise, it's not just knowing God's precepts that bring about great value. The greater understanding and wisdom the psalmist is referring to comes from keeping them as we live and include them in our lives. Moving on to verse 101, we read, I hold back my feet from every evil way in order to keep your word. In our hearts, in our conscience, all of us know what is right, what is wrong, what is good, what is evil. Here in this verse, the psalmist is telling us that when we recognize evil that comes across our paths or perhaps even thoughts that might come across our mind, that the psalmist actively resists. He holds back from allowing his body to walk down that path of evil with its associated consequences. Now, while he and none of us are able to always do this. Certainly as believers, we endeavor to do so that we might keep God's word, to keep ourselves holy and pure as God is also holy and pure, to keep us in God's will and not falling into the traps and snares of the evil one, not in order to be saved, but because we are saved and are truly God's children, trusting in him as our heavenly and loving Father. Likewise, we read in verse 102, I do not turn aside from your rules, for you have taught me. As the good father that loves and teaches his children, disciplining them when necessary, God's word provides the rules for our lives. Again, not to determine our relationship with God, but because of the relationship that we have with him. A relationship of trust where we hear and heed God's teachings, that we might be covered by his hand, protected by his reach, provided for by his love, so that he is pleased with us as we model and demonstrate to the world exactly whose we are. And with respect to keeping all that God's word teaches us, the psalmist declares then in verse 103, how sweet. How sweet are your words to my taste, sweeter even than honey itself to my mouth. Here we see a sense of pleasure, a sense of desire for the sweetness and the satisfaction that comes from God's word. The psalmist uses the illustration of honey, pure, natural sweetness that is pleasing to our tongues and to our mouths. Maybe you like ice cream or candy or the sweet taste of chocolate as it runs over your tongue and down your throat. Whatever appeals to you, that's what the psalmist is likening God's word to. A sensual pleasure that we crave, that we pursue, that we want. And unlike the sweets of this world, God's word is completely free of all calories and anything else that might be harmful to our bodies. It is completely nutritious, completely healthy, and completely wholesome. And we can have as much of it as we want, and it will never hurt us, never harm us. Lastly, in verse 104, the last of the verses that begin with the Hebrew letter mem, the psalmist writes, through your precepts I get understanding, therefore I hate every false way. Here we see the underlying principle of understanding that comes from truth, and how every falsehood then becomes something to stay away from, something to reject, something to hate, because of what it does to the truth of God's word, to the truth of God's character, to the truth of God's ways. Satan loves to do this. He loves to distort the truth, to twist it to fit his desires, his plans, his purposes, all while trying to make it look good and pleasing and desirable. When we truly know God's precepts, his word, when we truly have an intimate understanding of the God that is revealed in the Bible, when we can see and understand from God's perspective what we were missing before our salvation, then we can turn from everything that is evil, everything that is wrong, everything that is false, including all the teachings from those who seek to distort the truth of God for their own selfish and greedy purposes. God's precepts give us clarity to see the deceptions and falsehoods of the enemy so that we can clearly see and discern the traps that he has set for us, that we might successfully navigate them and not fall victim to his plans and designs, and are able to turn away from those things that previously may have ensnared us. As we come to love and understand then the truth as contained in God's word, we come to inherently hate all that is in opposition or even in contradiction to that truth, seeking to free others as well from the lies of the world that trap them as well. And so here in the last verse, we see the antithesis, the opposite then of what we saw in our first verse, hating every false way that comes from and about the understanding and truth of God's word, as opposed to the love that we have for God's law, for his word, for the revelation of truth that comes so that we can truly see and not be deceived. In just these 8 short verses, we see just a glimpse of what God's word can do for us in our life. We see just a glimpse of the goodness, of the love, of the relationship we have with our Heavenly Father and how He wants us to learn to live our lives for our goodness and benefit as well as for His glory. We have just a glimpse of the true character of God as it is revealed in His precious Word. And we have just a glimpse of how His Word not only brings life, but makes our life better, giving us understanding and wisdom that we may apply it in our daily lives. My hope is that this sermon today sparks a flame of desire and hunger in all of us to want more of God and His Word in our lives, that we might not only benefit from it, but that we may be truly able then to say, Lord Jesus, oh, how I love Your law. It is my meditation all the day and every day of my life. Thank You for Your Word as it brings life to me and glory to You. Let's pray. Lord, forgive us for perhaps the ways in which we underappreciate the 66 books, the inspired revelation that have been written down, words that You spoke through Your Holy Spirit, not mechanically, but using the lives, the giftings, and the experiences of those authors that You inspired to bring about this revelation of who You are, who we are, what this world is all about. Father, the goodness in terms of the relationship that we have with You, the enormous cost that our sin demanded of You for us to be redeemed, forgiven, and reconciled, the immense love and mercy that You extend to us, the wisdom to be able to navigate, to live life here in this world in such a way that is pleasing to You, keeping us from the sinful consequences of our own actions. Father, we thank You for every scribe that went ahead and made the copies that we have now that provide testimony to the truthfulness, the sincerity, and the authenticity of Your Word to us. The Word that You have protected now for close to 4,000 years, including both the Old and the New Testaments, protected from the elements, protected from the enemy for just burning, disparaging, and trying to eliminate. Lord, forgive us for the fact that we have such ample access to it today. Where before in the past there were those that sought to actively keep the Word of God away from the church members, those that were motivated to bring the Word, the written Word, to us, the various persecutions that they went through as well. And Father, for all the false teachings that come about, both verbally and written, that seek to undermine and minimize Your Word today, we thank You that You have protected and given us it, that it may edify our lives as we live the lives that You have called and purposed us to live, protecting us and glorifying You. Lord, how we love Your Word. Help us to love it even more. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. Ms. Aussie?
Three forty-two.
First verse.
Father, in the name of the Son, in the name of the Holy Spirit.